Developing a fuller understanding of human development is essential if we are to create optimal learning environments at our schools. Today, we'll talk about stages of cognitive development and consider how that intersects with classical education. Hi, I'm Patrick Egan with Educational Renaissance, where we promote a rebirth of ancient wisdom for the modern era. In my latest blog article on Educational Renaissance, I developed some ideas about the stages of childhood cognitive development. In this video, I'll walk us through Piaget's four stages of development, and we'll consider how his theory relates to our educational renewal movement. We'll also see how recent neuroscience gives us a more complete picture of the cognitive development of children. Stick around to the end where I'll spell out some practical considerations that I didn't include in the article. Well, let's dive in. So the classical Christian education movement has a long history thinking about child cognitive development. We can go back to the Dorothy Sayers essay, The Lost Tools of Learning, where she maps the trivium grammar, logic, rhetoric onto three stages of child development: the Paul Parrot stage, the Pert stage, and the Poet stage. It was a rudimentary understanding of development, and I think many classical schools have moved away from a strict adherence to the Sayers schema. Well, what Piaget developed was a series of four stages. The first, the sensory motor stage, runs from birth to two. This is about physical reflexes and bodily function. Even though so much of this stage is physical, the mind is very active as the child comes to grips with the world. Connections are being made. In the second stage, a child moves into what's called the pre-operational stage. At the time they start speaking, the child absorbs language from the people around them. But it's not only about language. The child begins to play imaginatively, making up stories, playing house, pretending. Children also learn how to play with each other. When you watch a child play, you can actually observe a change in their understanding of the rules as they get older. When they are really young, they might have a very basic understanding of what the rules of the game are. As a matter of fact, they might find it very difficult to articulate what those rules are. Wait a few years and they'll know exactly what the rules are, especially when somebody breaks them. In the third stage, around the age of seven, children move into what is called the concrete operational stage, where logic and reasoning emerge. They are able to make logical connections or causal predictions. However, children at this stage will still have difficulty with certain abstract concepts. In the fourth stage, around 11 years old, children move into the formal operational stage. Here's where students can philosophize about abstract concepts. They can tackle multifactorial problems. In addition, they are better able to apply executive function, meaning they can think about their own learning and apply complex organizational skills. These are the four basic stages, but insights from cognitive science and neurobiology have augmented our understanding of these stages. First, no learner moves through these stages in a static fashion. A child might take leaps forward in his or her ability to read, but that advance might not translate into other subjects. We might call this a staggered approach or a modular approach to development. One module is developed while another one lags behind, and these modules might develop at different rates. Second, certain key cognitive skills like decentering, conservation, and reversibility are real milestones in cognitive development. Many of these milestones occur by the time the child is seven. Decentering is the ability to see multiple attributes of a single object. This skill is essential to reading, being able to see that the symbols, the letters, are different than the words themselves, and that the words carry meaning in quite a different way than the letters function as symbols. Conservation is the ability to recognize that a quantity remains the same even if you change the shape of it. Reversibility is the concept that something can be restored to its original condition or its starting place after it's been transformed. Third, at a neurological level, we know that the biology of the brain stands behind some of these cognitive breakthroughs. For instance, the prefrontal cortex is still getting wired to the amygdala during the early years of development. This weak connection between the prefrontal cortex and the amygdala means that young children are much more curious and uninhibited than their older selves. As the prefrontal cortex develops and matures, the child gains more impulse control and decision-making ability. Hopefully this walk through childhood cognitive development has fired your own neurons and is getting you thinking about your children in your classroom or your home and ways that they might be developing as learners. Well, I mentioned I would like to give you a few practical considerations as you hone your craft of teaching. There are some ideas I didn't put in my original article, so if you've listened this far, you're about to get some really valuable insights you can't get anywhere else. First, if you're working with really young children, especially before the age of 7, you can apply your knowledge of these concepts to better observe what is really going on inside their little minds. For instance, you might observe a child pouring a liquid from one container to another. When you can understand that this action is part of the process of learning conservation, you might be more inclined to maximize that learning moment rather than stopping a potentially messy activity. Second, every subject is connected to what we might call master skills. There are numerous discrete topics, for instance, in, say, mathematics. But learning how to follow steps forward and backward really helps develop the cognitive skill of reversibility. What this means is when we're teaching mathematics, in some ways we're not actually teaching mathematics, we're teaching something else. We're teaching mastery in a particular cognitive skill. Now, of course, we're still teaching mathematics, but when we as teachers understand that there's some background mechanics or like a background operating system working, it helps us to see that there's multiple levels to what we're doing in the classroom. Third, practice and academic and personal habits are connected to the myelinization of neurons. Now, myelin is a fatty substance that wraps around neurons, making them more effective. This myelin coating occurs when certain processes are repeated. You see, the brain starts to think, if this guy is doing it over and over again, we better protect those neurons so they're ready to go at a moment's notice. It makes things happen quicker and more regularly. Well, think about practicing scales on the piano over and over again. Well, that builds myelin. Practicing sitting up straight in your classroom over and over again is going to build myelin in those nerves in the brain. So think about the skills your learners most need to develop and schedule time to practice, practice, practice. Well, here at Educational Renaissance, we are promoting a rebirth of ancient wisdom for the modern era. If you'd like to stay up to date on new videos, be sure to subscribe to our YouTube channel. You can also find lots of great articles and resources at educationalrenaissance.com. You can download my ebook on habit training and learn more about what it looks like to incorporate habit training into your classroom or home. You can also listen to our podcast through any of the many podcast platforms that are out there. Just look for the Educational Renaissance podcast. Well, thanks for listening. We'll see you again.